Being here this morning in Romans chapter 13. Romans chapter 13. Appreciate the hospitality already. They have us stay with Brother Manny and Sister Mary. And what a wonderful place. I can see why you call this God's country. After being at Brother Manny's house. That's a blessing from the Lord. And they took us on an ATV ride last night on top of the hills. And was that sunset ever beautiful? That was just beautiful, seeing the sunset in Virginia. We don't see a lot of sunsets in Montana because of the mountains. And so to see that sunset last night after that rain and thunderstorm on the top of the hills of Virginia was really a wonderful sight. So thank you for this. We are looking forward to the affiliated meetings, and the Lord has been working on us in the Montana church, all of us, and I believe the Lord is preparing our hearts for what he has in store for us. One of the things that I've been getting for us at the Montana church is that the Lord is going to give us opportunity to repent. I don't know what the apostles are going to be preaching. I don't know what they're going to be bringing out, but I do know that the Lord's going to give us an opportunity to repent, and that's a good thing. When the Bible says that God chastens those that he loves, and so I get concerned if we're not chastened every once in a while, if we're not corrected every once in a while. It concerns me if that doesn't happen. So we've been really humbled recently. We had Apostle Esh in Montana recently and been really humbled. And the Lord is breaking us. And I believe he's preparing his people for what he has in store for these affiliated meetings. So he's conditioning our hearts. You know, the value of a rebuke in time and by the order of God is a very healthy thing. The value of the chastening of the Lord and the correction of the Lord. I just had a situation recently in Montana where someone was going the wrong direction and was really feeling the effects of that direction and was crying out. I could tell there was a crying out for some answer, some deliverance, some way, somehow. And I'm a type of person, I like to encourage people. I like to bring a word that encourages people. I don't so much like to bring a rebuke. And when I know that I have to bring a rebuke, I don't like to do that. But because of the fear of the Lord, it's necessary. And when I see that in order for this person to be free in this situation, it requires a word of correction or rebuke. And I never saw someone so set free by a rebuke as I did on this one. Never experienced it in my life. The fellow was crying out for something. And when I brought the sharp word of rebuke, he was set free in 5 minutes. He acknowledged God was speaking. And I never saw a man so set free by, you know, it reminded me of, and I'm not calling myself a prophet, I'm just doing what God told me to do. But it reminded me of Nathan when he came to David. David was in sin. I'm not sure how long the process was from the time that David had Uriah killed and committed adultery until Nathan came on the scene. But there came a time where Nathan came on the scene and explained to him a situation that really hit home with David's heart about that about this rich man that took this poor man's sheep. And he said, "You're the man." And when he said that, David broke. And there was true repentance with godly sorrow, and it produced a man after God's own heart. It did something in the spirit. So what I'm saying is, I'm not looking for opportunities to rebuke. We're not trying to do it out of the flesh, but when it's done right in God's order and in God's way, it can set people free. And so that's why I'm saying yes, we are coming into these meetings, and I want to be open to the conviction of the Holy Spirit, to the correction of the Holy Spirit, to the rebuke, if it is a rebuke by the Lord, or maybe an encouragement, whatever it is, to be open to it and allow the Lord to set his people free. All right, let's just go to, if we have your Bibles, Romans chapter 13. I'll begin reading in verse 11. I've entitled this message this morning, Awaken to Our Heavenly Priority. Awaken to Our Heavenly Priority. Romans chapter 13, verse 11, it says, And that knowing the time, that now it is high time. Everyone say high time. It's high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. Let's just pray one more time. Father in heaven, I thank you for the Holy Spirit. I thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit that breaks yokes, that sets people free. I thank you for that grace this morning to do what you've called us to do, to walk in our God-given purpose and agendas. And I thank you for the strength to deliver this word in Jesus' name. Amen. It says here, knowing the time, it's high time to awake out of sleep. And he says, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. I believe all of us realize that we live in exactly in the time that it's talking about right here. The day is at hand. And so he encourages us to put off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. And I want to go through this today and just talk a little bit about what does it mean to put on the armor of light, because we live in a time where I believe that it is very important that we are awake. Here he says it's high time that we wake out of sleep, that we put on the armor of light. The Lord has really been getting on my case recently about this, and I've been on this passage of Scripture for the last month. And I just believe that the Lord is in the process of waking up his people to a lot of different things. And he's doing it. He's waking up not people in the world. Yes, he might be some, but he's waking up the people in the church to his God-given priority and purpose. I went through read a research recently of Montana, and this is coming from Billy Graham's son, Franklin Graham, and I guess he's gone around to the different states and encouraging people to pray this year. But he did a survey on Montana, and on that survey, it went through how many Christians, how many Mormons, what percent of each category is there. And it said on that survey that Montana is 60% casual Christian. And I think it's 1% Mormon and 1% Muslim and 20% atheist, it was. But I looked at that and I couldn't get away from it. It bothers me to see that. 60% casual Christian. Now, the reason this bothers me is, and here's my problem. I'm not sure that it's going to turn out well for the casual Christian. When I looked up the word casual, it put it in the same category as lukewarm. So I want to know, how can we take what's there right now, what's here right now, and go from what they call casual Christianity to true spirit-filled, Bible-based, revival-filled Christianity? I looked up the word casual, and it means this: indifferent to what is happening, apathy, feeling or showing little concern, nonchalant, a casual approach, lacking a high degree of interest or devotion, done with serious, not with serious intent or commitment. Shallow, superficial. And likely one of the most serious areas that we lack in this country, I believe, and are guilty in of, is biblical knowledge and Bible-based practice of that knowledge. I was researching this, and I found an illustration of the percentage of believers in this country. And it said that builders, what they called the builders from 1927 to 1945, 65% were Bible-based believers from 1927 to 1945. And then they have from 1946 to 1964 is what they called the boomers. And that was Bible-based believers, according to this study, was 35% Bible-based believers. Then the busters, born from 1965 to 1983, it says it was 16% Bible-based believers. And then the generation they called the bridgers, born from 1984 or later, was 4% Bible-based believers. That concerns me, and I believe it's concerning to the Lord. And I've never been so... The Lord's awakening us to some things. And he's awakening me in Montana to some of these realities. And it bothers me when there's no longer a Bible base, there's lawlessness and mixture of every kind. It opens a people to all kinds of doctrines of devils and ideas and opinions of men that totally make the Word of God ineffective in their lives. Obviously, serious Bible study and prayer times are waning in these days. Many people have stopped bringing their Bibles to church in recent years. Someone said it like this: I wonder what would happen if we treated our Bible like our cell phone. We would carry it everywhere we go, flip through it throughout the day. We would go home and get it if we forgot it. We would receive messages from the text.
Yeah, that's right.
We couldn't live without it. Parents would give it to their children as gifts. It would be available for all emergencies and any and all conversations. One more thing, it would never be disconnected, as Jesus has already paid the bill in full. Someone made this statement about casual Christianity. If many Christians went to their jobs each day as they go to church, millions of Christians would be fired They show up late, they show up bored. When they are there, they're somewhere else. Or they fall asleep without interest. Or they don't want accountability or correction. It will get better before the end of the message. This is his fault. This man has preached the gospel for years, and I know that he's on this thing. The Bible talks about these kinds of groups and the reality of the situation. Now, before you get off the hook, let me do this. I looked up the survey for Virginia. So in Virginia, according to the recent survey, there's 8,326,000 people that live in Virginia. The religious profile is as follows. Casual Christian, 71%. Captive Christian, 16%. Jewish, 1%. Mormon, 1%. New Age, Eastern religion, 1%. Muslim, 1%. Atheist, agnostic, 10%. And so it appears it's a nationwide problem that we have. You had 25,413 abortions in 2011 in this state. But the Bible talks about these kind of groups and these kinds of people. And I believe the Lord is going across this country and calling people to wake out of sleep. And one of the ways we do that is what's found in Romans chapter 13, where it says, put off the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. One of these groups in Luke chapter 14, let me just read it. Verse 16 says, then said he unto him, a certain man made a great supper and bade many. This is a man having a supper, getting this huge meal ready, and he's bidding many people to come. And he sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must go and see it. I pray thee have me excused. Another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee have me excused. And another said, I've married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring hither the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, go out to the highways and hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of these men which were bidden shall taste of my supper. Now here were a people that were selling land. Nothing wrong with selling land. Here were a people that were selling cows. Nothing wrong with selling cows. Here was somebody that was getting married. And nothing wrong with getting married. But it's a matter of priority. Here was a people that were too busy for God. They had their agenda. They had their way of doing things. They had their mind made up. They had their schedule set. And even God wasn't going to intervene. When they were bidden, he said, those will not taste of my supper. The other category I see of in the Bible of this kind of example is of the story of the 10 virgins. There was 5 foolish virgins who were casual and never made the wedding. They were preoccupied with their thing. Yes, called Christians, and yet they were preoccupied. They were a casual about the priorities of God. They were not watching. They were not seeking. They were not preparing. They saw Bible reading as optional. If it doesn't fit my schedule or my lifestyle, it's optional. They saw prayer as an option. It was not priority. It wasn't something that they made first in their life, but it was an option. Their things came first. Their lives came first. Their families came first. Their weddings came first. Their activities came first. Here were people who considered the assembling of themselves with the believers as optional. Their things came first. They were not seeking. They were not preparing. They were not about the Father's business or concerning themselves with His will for their lives. They were off doing their own thing and hoping everything would work out. The sobering thing about this is there's going to be many people that think they're okay who will hear those words, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I never knew you." They were more concerned about their own lives than they were about fulfilling the will of God, than they were about engaging in the king's business. They had too many other things planned, and the spiritual things just didn't fit into that plan. The lukewarm church that you see in Laodicea in Revelation chapter 3 was casual about spiritual things. Yes, they had money. Yes, they had things going for them. On the outside, they were rich. They were increased with goods, they said. They even were saying this, "We have need of nothing." These are those who the Bible says God will spew out of His mouth. See, casual Christianity equals casualty. It will not end up well with a lukewarm Christian. Unless they repent. Casual Christianity equals casualty. Esau, you all know the story. Just recently, we've got the quarterly from Brother Rhodes, and he talked about Jacob and Esau, talked about Esau. Esau was casual about his birthright. He was casual about his calling in God. He was casual about his God-given purpose. It says he despised his birthright. He considered it small. He considered it as worthless. He was casual about his calling, about his purpose in God. And this opened him up to all kinds of issues. And that's the way it works when we are casual about our God-given purpose. It opens us up to all kinds of issues, all kinds of temptations, all kinds of the works of the flesh that want to dominate our thinking and our way of living. He despised his birthright. The Bible says it calls Esau a fornicator. He treated his calling lightly. See, that's one of the reasons when somebody asks me to preach, I can't say no. His brother asked, I can't say no. There would be something wrong, and it would bother me. I would feel like I'm putting God's purpose on the shelf. But he despised this birthright. He didn't care about his God-given purpose in life. He treated it lightly, and it did not end up well with Esau. Here's what God said about Esau in Romans chapter 9 and verse 13. He says, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Jacob, on the other hand, was not casual in his pursuit for God's blessing and his benediction. He sought until he found. Was Jacob perfect? Far from it. Jacob was far from perfect. But Jacob had a heart bent towards God. Jacob had a hunger and thirst for the blessing and the benediction of heaven operating in his life. And there's nothing wrong with that. We heard this morning from Apostle Kevin. This is something that we need. Is the blessing of Abraham, is the blessing of heaven, is his benediction upon our lives. This is how we become salt and we become light and we make a difference in our world. Jacob was not casual in his pursuit for God. He sought until he found. This is what God is calling us to wake up to awaken to a hunger and a thirst for the kingdom of God. We just came from Pennsylvania this last evening, and I went to the prayer meeting with the people there in Pennsylvania on Wednesday evening, and that's what they were praying for, and I joined in. God, make us hungry. God, make us thirsty for you again. Waken us to hungering and thirsting for you. And they were praying, God, make your ministers a flame of fire in these affiliated meetings. I'm looking forward to this. Amen. Make your ministers a flame of fire and let it burn. How about making a new statistic in Virginia in the next 10 years? How about somebody does a survey and they can no longer say 71% casual Christian? But they say there's another percentage in there of some kind that says revival Bible-based believers that have been with Jesus in Virginia. Somebody says, why not 100%? Well, let's get on the board first, right? Let's make enough of a difference to where it gets the people's attention that do the surveys. The apostles in the Bible affected their known world. Part of putting on the armor of light is giving attention, I believe, to our heavenly priorities. See, for the people there that were invited to this feast, those things aren't wrong. We all have these things that we do, but it's an issue of priority. It's an issue of what's first in our lives. It's an issue of what is our heart bent towards. Are we leaning into God 24/7? Or are there so many other things that are robbing, killing, and destroying our faith and our single-mindedness in God? Hebrews chapter 10, verse 39 says, But we are not of them. Everyone say, not of them. Say, that's not me. Who draw back unto perdition. We are not of them, but we are these, of them that believe to the saving of the soul. That's us. Everyone say, that's me.
That's me.
Say it again.
That's me.
Just like to hear you say that. I want to hear myself say that. That's me, to believe to the saving of the soul in 2016. I think most of us thought the world was going to end by now. But we're all still here, aren't we? And it's time to awake to our heavenly priorities. It's time to be zealous about our heavenly priorities. Somebody mentioned zeal or enthusiasm, Brother Eric, this morning. Defeating. Here's where this has bothered me for the last month, and I'm sure you can tell. Defeating casual Christianity. How do we do that? And I'm so glad we have men like these apostles, because I know they're on this thing. How do we defeat this casual Christianity? What heavenly priorities should we wake up to? I have a few here. I wrote down a few that I'd like to mention this morning that I believe are important. I'm sure there's a lot more, but here's a few for you. Awake to forgiveness. The Bible simply says, if we do not forgive, we cannot be forgiven. And so I want to encourage the body of Christ wherever I go, be proactive in making a decision today that every human being that ever does good or bad to me has my forgiveness. And I think it's a good idea to make that decision early in life. Make that decision early, young people, children, teenagers. Make a decision today that it doesn't matter what life throws at me. It doesn't matter what opportunity I have to be offended. It doesn't matter how bad it might be or come from, even if it's my best friend, they have my forgiveness. And I choose to be proactive. And I decide today that they're going to have my forgiveness. I'm sure many of us here have had opportunities like this in the past. And I'm sure we'll have many opportunities in the future to forgive. Life isn't fair. People have told me that. It never will be fair. So we might as well just get over it, suck it up, and forgive, right? I wasn't planning on saying that, but somehow, some way, brother. Life isn't fair. Someone takes advantage of me. Grudges, the envy, the bitterness. See, here's what has helped me when there's life isn't fair. And there's all kinds of people out there everywhere constantly being unjust, constantly causing opportunity for offense. And we can rip and tear and try to explain our way through and try to make our point and try to make this happen or make that happen. But this is what has helped me. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father, right now the things that are motivating them to hate me, to destroy me, to do evil to me, is of another spirit. It's not really them. It's another spirit ordered by the devil to make them do what they're doing. So, Father, I forgive them as a person, as your creation. For they know not what they do.
That's right.
I think it's time we awaken to forgiveness. Good. Where we can have what we have here this morning. Mm-hmm. The unity of the Spirit. Where God can command His blessing. We'd have a better future if we could live like that. Mm-hmm. Somebody said life is short, so eat cake, right? Or life is short, eat dessert. I say life is short, too short to hold grudges and negative attitudes towards people. It's too short to do it. Be quick to ask forgiveness if you wrong someone. Someone recently just confessed jealousy to me. Jealousy. And I'm thinking, oh, yeah. Why jealous of me? And he said, I've just been blessed, jealous. You're blessed, and I'm jealous. And I said, you have my forgiveness. I said, I'm nobody special, man. I'm nobody special. And he said, you submit to God, right? Is that what it is? I said, that's exactly right. You submit to God, and God can bless that, like Apostle Kevin was saying this morning. The answer is submit to God. And then let God bring what he wants. Let God do the blessing. But we get ourselves in trouble when we seek the blessing instead of the blesser. And we get caught up with the blessing inside of all of it. So submit to God. Let God work it out. The important thing is that we're submitting to God. Then we have the authority. Then we have the power. Then we have what it takes to resist the devil. And you know what? He has to flee. We get caught up with the blessing, robs us of our authority in God. But when we submit to God and his way of doing things, God gives authority and God brings the blessing in whatever way he chooses. Seek first the kingdom of God and let God work out the blessing. Number two, heavenly, what priorities should we awaken to? Number two is repentance. Repentance. I found myself recently, and the Lord was getting on my case about this. Lord, I repent of being casual about spiritual things. I repent of that, about being casual about spiritual things. Jesus told, now here's the good news. Yes, we might have a nation. We might have a state where the overriding survey is 71% casual Christian. But here's the good news. Jesus told the Laodicean church, he said, in your current state, I will spew you out of my mouth. But he told the church in Laodicea, he said, be zealous. Be zealous and repent. I believe it's time we awaken to be zealous about repentance. To be eager to repent. If we have opportunity to repent in these affiliated meetings, to say, yes, Lord, I repent of this. This is the last time in my life for this thing. I repent. Be zealous. Repentance should be something we're ready to do at any moment if we're leaning into God. If we're bent towards the kingdom of God, there's a, like I said before, a crying out to be delivered. And sometimes repentance is the answer to that deliverance and victory and freedom and light back in the eyes again. To be zealous about repentance when there's conviction, rather than trying to prove I'm right or prove my own way or prove my agenda, to say, God, I repent. I've been doing it wrong. I've been too nonchalant. I've been too casual about this. And Father, I repent of this thing when we receive conviction. See, here's the deal. It's going to work out well with the repentant. It's going to work out well with them. Those that are zealous and they repent, the Bible talks about some overcoming some things in there in the book of Revelation. There is some good things for the believer. There are some wonderful things. There are some overcoming things that I'm sure I haven't even begun to tap into for the overcoming Christian, for the one who's zealous, who's awakened to the zealousness of repentance and brokenness before a holy God. Says, God, your way, I'm surrendering to your way, to your will, your purpose in my life. Number three. Awaken to our personal time with God. Leviticus chapter 6 and verse 13 says, the fire shall ever be burning upon the altar. It shall never go out. The fire shall ever be burning upon the altar. it shall never go out. I like the scripture that says, I will make my ministers a flame of fire. Just like in the Old Testament, how they work, they kept that fire burning on the altar, and it never goes out. God wants us to burn for Him. And I believe there's some things that God calls us to encourage that fire to burn, to allow that fire to burn. And I believe that taking that personal time with God in that secret place, in that shut-in time with God, gives opportunity for that fire to burn. And I believe there's many around this country that are waning in this area of their personal time with God. And it results in a casual lifestyle. Personal maintenance and discipline can help to keep the fire burning in your soul. Mary in the Bible, you remember the story of Mary and Martha. Martha's going about busy, doing a lot of good things. But Mary, Jesus says, has chosen that which is needful. Everyone say, needful. Mary is sitting at the feet of Jesus, listening to His word. Jesus says, Mary chose that which is needful. This will help keep the fire burning in our soul. When we choose that which is needful over all the other activities, over all the fleshly and natural priorities and entertainment, but we choose in the midst of 2016 that which is needful. I believe it's time for the church to awake to that which is needful, to keep the fire on the altar burning in this hour and in this generation. There's so many things out there that want to take, rob you from that, and from that fire in your soul, the enthusiasm in God, the zealousness of the gospel. Mary chose that which was needful. There was two men on their way to Emmaus. You remember the story when after Jesus was risen from the dead, and they're walking on their way to Emmaus, and they're communicating and talking about Jesus being crucified and gone forever, and they're downcast and they're sad. Jesus comes in the middle of them as a person, as a man. They did not recognize Him. And He says this, "What manner of communications are these that ye have with one another as ye walk and are sad?" As ye walk and are sad. How many sad Christians are there out there today? As ye walk and are sad. Jesus is walking right in the midst of them, and they're walking and they're sad. Goes on to say, and they said to one another, after their eyes were opened and they realized this was the Son of God, this was Jesus, they said this one to another, did not our heart burn within us? Burn within us while He talked with us? By the way, and while He opened up the scriptures to us, did not our hearts burn? I believe we need to awaken again, church, and awaken the body of Christ to where our hearts burn again. Where our hearts burn again, because we're doing that which is needful and allowing the scriptures to be opened by the man of God or by the word of God or through prayer or through the Holy Spirit ministering to our hearts and allowing our hearts to burn. This is a healthy heartburn. This is the kind of heartburn we should all have. Be zealous about dwelling in the secret place of the Most High God in this generation. Be zealous about shutting in with God. See, a weak prayer life equals little strength. When there's little strength spiritually, and this is why the Bible says about John the Baptist, it said this about Jesus, that they wax strong in the Spirit. See, when we wax strong in the Spirit, it's like a healthy immune system in the body. When we have a healthy immune system in this body, there's a cut that we might get in our hand, or there's a bite that we might get. It's that healthy immune system that causes everything in our body to go for that thing and do what it takes to bring healing to that part of the body. It actually keeps us from getting sick when we have a healthy immune system. It attacks that thing, it takes care of it, and we don't get sick. When that healthy, many times when we're sick, it's because of a negative immune system. Recently, I had what they call hives. Anyone know what hives are? If you don't want hives, by the way, but I had hives. They said it came from a broken down immune system. So I had to change my coffee lifestyle. But my immune system was being broken down, and so it wasn't able to fight off the hives. And my goodness, you don't want them. It's so itchy, it burns. It's not a good thing. So I had to do things, and I'm still working on it, to encourage my immune system physically. When there's a weak spiritual immune system, it opens us up to all kinds of evils that would like to take over in our lives. And there's some things we can do to encourage a healthy spiritual immune system, that when the temptations come, you know what? They're not going to affect me. When the opportunities come to go here or go there, there's nothing in me that wants to go that direction because I've been filled with the Holy Spirit. That healthy immune system to fight off that which is evil. See, when that is broken down, when there's little strength spiritually, it opens us up to all kinds of issues. Next thing you know, we're having to battle bitterness. We're having to battle envy. So, let's awaken to our personal time with the Lord. That which encourages a healthy immune system. Peter, for example, he became casual in his pursuit and closeness to Christ. When Jesus went to the cross to be crucified, the Bible says that Peter followed afar off. Now here he was 3 years prior to this, close to Christ. Jesus goes to the cross now. Now it's hard. It's the cross. It's not the 10,000 followers. It's him alone, and he's going to the cross. And Peter decides to follow afar off. When he did that, the flesh began to take over. He did things he never dreamed or imagined that he would do when he followed afar off, when he became casual in his pursuit and his closeness with the Master. The flesh took over. He didn't want to follow because he's going to the cross. Just let me sit by the sidelines. Just let me watch from a distance. Next thing you know, he finds himself denying the Lord. He finds himself lying, something that he thought he would never do. He falls into all kinds of temptations and lusts because he no longer has the spiritual strength to fight off the evil. He lost his closeness to Christ. But the good news is, when that cock did crow three times, he looked and there's Jesus looking at him, and there was repentance like no other. There's brokenness that came from that like no other. Here's a man came from that, rose up, and began preaching the gospel by submission to God, and turned a world, a known world, upside down or right side up, whichever you will. He got the world's attention through repentance and brokenness and submission to God and his plan for his life. It was David, when he put the Lord's purpose on the back burner, that he fell into the sin of adultery and murder. He lost his strength. He lost his vitality. He lost the burning of his soul. When he put God's purpose on the back burner, when he said, I'm just going to watch from the sidelines. I just want to be casual about this thing. See, we walk away from communication and the purpose of Christ. We lose our strength. You lose your fight. And we lose a healthy immune system. Jesus said these words in Matthew chapter 10, verse 37, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Nothing wrong with a healthy relationship with father and son, brother, sister, mother, daughter. We want healthy relationships, great relationships. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. But it's a matter of priority. And he that taketh not up his cross and followeth after me, he said, is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. Family is a good thing. But if family keeps us from serving God, we have a problem. Jesus says, you're not worthy of me. And so Jesus says, if you want to follow me, be willing to take up your cross and follow me the whole way. The whole way. Stay close, connected to the Master. Do the things. Do the things. Do the things that prove to the Lord that he is highest priority in your life. Do the things that prove to him that you're serious. Awaken to our heavenly priorities. Number four. I believe this is an area that can help us awaken to this heavenly priority of accountability with on-fire Christians. I think it's a good idea to be zealous about this one, to be open and accountable with on-fire Christians. Believers, here's the deal. We slowly, ever so slowly, gravitate toward the people that we spend the most time with. Slowly, we gravitate towards the people that we spend the most time with. And so it's important for us to choose our friends well. To choose those people, those men of God, those women of God that are at a higher spiritual level than we are, to influence our lives. Surround yourself with people that are more spiritual and challenge your way of life. Because these are the people that you will slowly, ever so slowly, gravitate towards. Now, if you choose the casual group, if you choose the lukewarm group, if you choose to let your guards down, and you choose these kinds of friendships and these kinds of relationships as an overriding factor and as a superior in your life, you will slowly, ever so slowly, gravitate their direction. This is a good one to be zealous about, to make sure you have the proper influence in your life, so that you gravitate in the right direction in the Lord. Accountability with on fire believers. The kind of people that when you share a dream with them, or you share what God's doing or wanting you to do, you want these kind of people that respond this way: is that all you're going to do? That's the kind of people you want in your life. Is that all you're going to do? You need the people that believe in you. You need the people in your life that see you for what you could be in 10 years rather than maybe what we are right now. See, there's something very, very powerful about a man of God or a woman of God that believes in us. It causes us to gravitate in that direction. We need people that have more faith and confidence in us than we do. Someone has been this in my life, and it's helped me tremendously. I know in the business world, I did not grow up in the business world. I did not know the first thing about business. And I remember years ago in Pennsylvania, I was working for someone. And I'm not saying everybody has to go run their own business. If God has you working for someone, that's wonderful and that's great. You're where God wants you. You're walking where God wants you. That's great. I never had, never even thought about, you know, owning my own business. It never even entered my mind. And I'm out there working one day, and the contractor that we're working for, the main fella, looked at me and said something like this: when are you going to go on your own and run your own business? And I looked at him and I thought about this, and I thought, well, I never even thought of that. I never considered that. And here was someone that had more confidence in me than I did. I went home to my wife and I said, this is what he said. And a few months later, I went out on my own and complete faith and ignorance about business and started. I had a $5,000 truck. We called it the cow because it was black and white. And I had a $300 hedge trimmer. And that was my investment. And so this fella began to give me work. And most of what I did was pull weeds. I got the work that no one else wanted to do. He had all these landscapers that he had, all these subcontractors, landscapers. Everything they didn't want to do, he had me do. And most of it was pulling weeds around, you know, things like poison ivy, if you know what that is. He looked at me the next time. And he said, Mark, by next year this time, you're going to be putting in patios. You're going to be putting in walkways. You're going to be doing hardscaping. Do you know that? I said, no, I don't know the first thing about hardscaping. But you know that did something to me? Exactly a year from then, I was building patios, walkways, all kinds of hardscaping. I'm just saying this to make a point. It's a powerful thing when a man of God or a leader speaks those things that are not as they were and believes in somebody. It will cause that person to rise to a level of faith and confidence that he might have never known before. So, it's important that we're zealous about surrounding ourselves with on-fire Christians. Because those are the ones we gravitate towards. Okay, number five. I'm about finished. I think I got, this is it. This is the last one. Be zealous about this one. Awaken to our priorities about being salt and light. About being salt and light. In other words, being concerned about what kind of testimony are we leaving in the earth, in the workplace, in our everyday life. What kind of testimony are we in our everyday life? Are we being salt? Are we being light? I had somebody recently come to me about my assistant pastor, which is Pastor J.D., and he said this about Pastor J.D. He said, he came to me, he's a contractor, came to me, said, I just like when Pastor J.D. is on the job site. He creates a healthy environment and a wonderful environment, and he's out there and he's getting it done, and it's not a drudgery, but he's actually, and you can tell he's enjoying work, right? Isn't that something new? We enjoy work. But he's out there and he's enjoying work. And this was a real testimony to this man. You don't see that much in the Bitterroot Valley where they enjoy work. But he's enjoying work and he's making it happen, and it stood out. So being light in a dark world. I had somebody at prison recently in the Deer Lodge prison. One of the guards, after we were done preaching, I couldn't figure out why he came into the, usually they stand outside, but this fella came in the sanctuary and was standing there while I was preaching. And I thought maybe he's just checking people out. Maybe he's looking for drugs or something, but he's standing there. And afterwards we talked a little bit, and he said, hey, I'm a Christian and I appreciate the word. He said, I've been here for 9 years. And I know these inmates by name in here, all of them. And I pray for them. And he said that it's a dark place. But he said, what I experience, what I enjoy here is, he said, I pray and God answers just like that. He said, it's so dark that when you say the simplest prayer, God answers. And he said, we see these answers to prayer over and over and over again. And he was just telling me how he so enjoys being in there. He said, this is my mission right here. But it was so dark. It's so dark in there that just a prayer, answered prayer, makes the difference. So being zealous about being salt and light and representing Christ correctly in attitude and character. There's all kinds of situations that I'm sure there's enough of people here that I'm sure that you face, I face in the workplace and working with people. We really have opportunities to blow it many times. But we also have an opportunity to be salt and to be light. And to answer a harsh word with love. To come back with a Christ-like attitude and character in the midst of it all can make the difference. You might be the only Bible some people will ever read in this dark world. Loyalty is a big part of it. Commitment, faithfulness to God is a big part of it. So be zealous about getting the gospel into the world. And I'm sure you are here in your prison. We heard the testimonies this morning. Zealous about being salt and light. And I'll close with this. There's an easy cure for casual Christianity. We need to begin by taking the Word of God seriously and putting it into practice. The Word says in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 33, "But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." The Bible says in Matthew 22 verse 37, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." This is the first and greatest commandment. When we begin to do even these simple things, along with some serious prayer and heart-rending repentance, we will begin to notice that our casual Christianity is starting to disappear. God bless you. All yours, brother.